that you know, you have your guys that are into Kim, mm-hmm. and then your guys that are into like players like Carlos and me and Howard. But see, it's interesting. Now, art sort of like you can only be into one or the other. I've never been like that. I've been really excited. But see, it's interesting. Now, RJ used to skateboard. Now, it's very similar type of thing because, now, I don't know if this was the way, I don't know, when you were skating, it might have been, this may have been starting or already happened, but there used to be sort of two very different schools.
Yeah.
And they called it Hesh and Fresh. Mm-hmm. And one was, you know, oh, this is, skating's about all raw power and going big and going fast. And then the other group of guys, you know, they didn't quite go as fast or whatever, they really technical. Mm-hmm. Lots of flip in tricks, flip out, and you know, but the moves weren't big or dangerous. And there were these sort of two separate schools, like, you know, like you had like Eric Costin and then you had like Corey Duffel or something. One would do huge rails and the other guy, you didn't see on such big stuff, but what he was doing was just as difficult on another level, but the danger factor wasn't quite as high. And now what you see in skateboarding is a melding of those two styles.
Yeah.
You're seeing very technical tricks down very big and dangerous stuff or just very technical stuff going really fast. And I think that you represent, you know, the first real generation of people, or maybe it's me, I don't know, or maybe Pat Ramsey. I would say actually maybe Pat kind of started this, where you have a high level of technique and skill study, some scales, some fast playing, mixed in with just some every now and then. Whereas, you know, you wouldn't expect that kind of sound out of Howard.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Total, yeah.
But now you're seeing some licks like... You're hearing a little bit of both and amplified the use of an amp. Whereas, I mean, Howard does use amps and does play amps, but, you know, he's not really an amp guy.
Yeah.
I'm not even sure he owns, you know, but anyway, you know what I mean? So that's interesting. And I think that the lack of discrimination in your study has played a huge part.
Yeah. It's I really truly love all harmonica. You know, it isn't just one thing that, you know, I really dig. So it's and I love the mixture just because you know during, you know, a portion of, if you're playing a blues or something, you can get you know playing a third, you can play that nice kind of that other, you know, that Carlos Alhungo kind of thing, and then you can bring, you know, and then you can just bring it in into that kind of that Kim Wilson. You can start like the
show us.
You know, you can put down.
Yeah. That sounds like Chris McCauley, right there.
Yeah. And you can juice it up. You know,
have you studied Chris?
I haven't really. I have kind of. You can kind of get how he was, because, you know, to get that kind of that jazzy kind of loose tone.
Mm-hmm.
Is he the way he's articulating?
That sounds just like Chris. That's cool.
Yeah. It's just that long, short kind of.
Yeah. That's funny. Chris is a very, well, I mean, he's a really kind of like an underground sort of influence. I mean, he doesn't have, his albums aren't widely distributed or anything, but I'm hearing his influence more and more all over the world.
Yeah.
Because of YouTube and other things like that.
Yeah. I haven't really studied too much, but I have like chat.
Is there
stuff a little bit.
Anybody else like that we might not know about that you've kind of picked something up off of?
Oh wow. That nobody knows of. I don't.
Not that nobody knows him, but that, you know, that sort of underground. I mean, for me, that was Pat.
Yeah.
And I mean, that name keeps popping up, but it's true. I mean, Pat was sort of an underground. If you didn't live on this coast,
the guy who I kind of really learned a lot from and just kind of how to do it is probably Alan Holmes. I don't know if anyone
that's
really
a great example.
Hears Alan at all, and he really, you know, he gets those.
That's a great example. Why don't you talk a little bit about Alan?
Alan kind of, he's actually a phenomenal jazz harmonica player.
Yeah. Well, let me stop you for a second. Yeah. How did people out there find Alan Holmes?
Alan Holmes is a Washington D.C. player. Mm-hmm. He plays out all like that. He teaches at John Ginnick camps. You can find him a lot there. He plays all around D.C. and he has a website that I believe is completely done right now. It's just alanholmes.com.
And that's
Holmes.
Yes. Okay.
.com and that's Alan just with two L's.
And he's a good friend of Dennis's.
Oh yeah. Dennis and him, you get them together, and you have yourself an amazing
party.
Time. Yeah. But
a nerd party.
Yeah. But Alan is like,
and I'd be happy. Yeah. By the way.
Alan is a phenomenal jazz harmonica player, and he does a lot of blues. If you ever hear him play some blues, he can nail blues as well. He said he's Sonny Boy for a long time. But he's the first one in my mind who ever took, you know, down at the octave kind of chordal playing, as in the split octaves. And he's the first one who ever like started to bend the fifth chords.
Yeah.
See,
that's something I just can't really do on a. You showed it to me last time, and I haven't practiced it at all. Yeah.
And he really takes that down to the. Bending that stuff.
Down. Alan's also an excellent chromatic player.
Oh, yeah.
Do
yeah.
you play
bass harp play too?
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't really
he's
know
amazing.
That. That's
amazing.
Interesting. Now, did you get into any orchestral instruments like bass harp or chord harp? Or?
I haven't. I have a
chromatic.
One of the three. I don't play much chromatic. I have one. I've tried it on it. Hearing Dennis play it totally got me in on it. But the only thing I really carry on me is one of those three octaves, low C's, just to get that low C octave, the long ones. So
you mean is it solo tuned, you mean?
No, it has the low C, middle C, and then the top
it's
C.
It's a 12-hole chromatic?
Yeah, I think it's 14-hole. 14-hole, just straight harp. Straight harp.
Okay.
One of those, and it's about that long, and just to get that
who makes
low
that?
C. A honer does.
Do you have that here?
Yeah, it's just the low.
Oh, that thing. Yeah. What is that? So what's the name of that? Is
that
the 364 or something?
Marine band, so it's kind of cool. And it's just your bottom C to...
Yeah.
So you have the low, you know. So
cool. So overblows.
Overblows.
When did you get into playing overblows?
Overblows came after I started studying my blues scale a lot. You know, I got into kind of third position playing, and at first, and what bugged me is first kind of not being able to use that middle part at all. Kind of bugged me just because I was like, well. You know, why can't I move up? And I have to go straight to the top octave after I play. And it was kind of, now you can get
into
that.
In first position he was talking about.
I think really kind of, you know, hearing Carlos, of course, you're like, well, what's he doing? But you really kind of got, you know, hearing you, I'm back in 05 at the House of Blues really opened my eyes.
Why?
Just the way you were doing it, and I still today I actually tell everyone that I still have the solo that you did. I recorded it mellow down, and it's the best mellow down solo I've heard you do in a long time. And just hearing your overblow and your overdraws, just how you are articulating.
I got a lot of the overdraw idea from Michael Peliquin, because there was like this one note on this CD that he had, the House of Cards CD, and it was the first time I had ever heard somebody not just like, kind of bend it.
And to be honest, it was there in my mind.
Peliquin. Peliquin.
And there's a phenomenal sax player too.
Yeah.